All right, thank you everyone for making it to the data minimization webinar. My name is Mary Casponzo. I am a developer advocate here at Clover, and I'm also the organizer of this developer webinars. We know it's been a pretty crazy year, and we hope that everyone is still healthy, safe, and woke. So if you're a developer who wants to build and submit apps that are more likely to be approved, or you want to figure out what permissions your app needs, or you want to figure out how to trim down the amount of permissions you're requesting so that you can open your app up to a broader audience, then congratulations, my friends. You are at the right webinar. The webinar speaker is Emily Lucek, Technical Solutions Engineer in the DevRel team. Emily helps developers solve app and tools related issues, and she also builds internal tooling for us. She is interested in education, especially where it intersects with interactivity. Emily's presentation will cover how you can achieve the points I've mentioned. Before we get started, just a little bit of logistics. The QA session will be a little different. Instead of having a live QA session after this webinar, we'll be having a live QA session throughout the webinar in the chat box to the right. Please feel free to ask your questions about the webinar in that chat box. A few of us from the Clover DevRel team will be online answering your questions. That's me, Adi, Rochelle, and Emily. All right, so without further ado, I'm going to pass the mic over to Emily.
Hi, everyone. I'm Emily, a technical solutions engineer on Clover's developer relations team. For today's topic, we'll be taking a closer look at Clover permissions, how they relate to your app's target audience, and how and why to minimize the permissions you request, thereby minimizing your data. All apps on Clover's app market need permissions to receive access to different datasets from Clover. Now, if you're creating a standard semi-integrated app, you may not require any extra permissions. And not all app market apps use permissions either. But if you do need Clover data, here's the sort of permissions to expect. Separate read and write permissions for customers, employees, inventory, merchant, orders, and payments, with the odd permission out for enabling online payments. These permissions must be specifically requested to help regulate access to sensitive information. All third-party developers should think about permissions at some point in the app-making process, even if it's to conclude that their app doesn't need any. If you're just starting to build your app or getting ready for approval, one big bonus to minimizing data, or the permissions you're requesting, is that this will simplify the app approval process. A handful of permissions where you've thoughtfully reviewed each as to its necessity in your app will lead to a much smoother review than a number of permissions with loose ties to your app's core functionality. And if you are at this stage in your process, check out our App Approvals Overview webinar for more information on how permission justifications fit into the larger approval process. We've conveniently linked it in the description below. Even if you're an established developer, reconsidering the relationship between your app and the data it uses can help you keep ahead of the curve, as concern about the storage and usage of data has recently been changing the digital landscape. Or you may want to see if you can broaden your user base to merchants who can't currently access your app. To start discussing data minimization, let's first take a look at PII. PII is any personally identifiable information, and Clover stores a lot of it, such as names, addresses, and phone numbers. There are degrees of separation with PII. Consider a standard piece of personal information, a first name. And consider how personal it is for an app to have the first name of the merchant who signed up for it. Compare that with how personal it is for the app to have the first name of an employee who works for that merchant, and then a customer who's just passing through, interacting with the employee who works for that merchant. As you get more distant, the concern over personal information can increase. The end customer may have no idea what apps a merchant uses, or what those apps could do with their information. and consider how much more personal you can get than a first name, especially when connecting data across permission categories. How much more personal can you get than spending habits? Because personal data needs to be handled with care, from a legal and ethical standpoint, data minimization often translates to PII minimization. In Clover terms, this translates to some permissions being more sensitive than others, such as the individual-centric employee or customer permissions. And some permission combinations are restricted under most circumstances, such as customer and order permissions, otherwise known as the aforementioned spending habits. This means that more sensitive or PII-bearing permissions may not allow for as much creativity in their use. Normally, we'd be delighted to see novel use of our APIs, but this becomes much more difficult to justify when PII enters the equation. Take the example of an employee management app that wants to store an employee's hire date to track work anniversaries. Clover's employee API does not include a date field, so the app wants to create matching customer objects for each of the employees and use the customer birth date as the hire date. Novel, right? But now, even if the developer never plans on making use of other customer data or functionality, the app still has access to all of this customer PII, for no reason that relates specifically to that data. In this case, instead of overhauling Clover's structure to shoehorn in a new bit of functionality, the developer would be free to keep track of the additional information in their own secure database. They could then integrate work anniversaries into their app without compromising customers. So, what sorts of Clover information can be sensitive? There are multiple schemas that may come into play, various laws such as GDPR and HIPAA, which we'll touch on next. But in general, anything about a specific individual might be sensitive. For example, the name of an employee, as opposed to the larger bucket of their role. Note also that UUIDs, or Universally Unique Identifiers, those 13-digit alphanumeric codes that Clover generates for just about anything, can be considered PII. Even without a name to attach or a phone number to contact, a customer UUID can establish behavioral patterns in the items they purchase, the amounts they spend. Be aware of the PII you're requesting for your app, whether you're planning to use it directly or whether you're receiving it incidentally as part of the chunked out dataset your permissions grant. If you're able to reorganize your app to request fewer sensitive permissions, your legal burden may similarly lighten. Special cases with your target audience may also tie into further PII concerns or add certain restrictions to the data you can request. As an example, let's take a look at GDPR. GDPR is the General Data Protection Regulation, active in the European Union. It imposes additional protections for customers and their data. In response, Clover has instated additional checks for apps that request customer PII. In the EU production environment, the customer's read and write permissions have been broken down into more specific fields. The base read write permissions only provide access to the customer ID, merchant ID, first name, last name, and customer since. Any additional information requires additional permissions, broken down by field. Addresses, email addresses, phone numbers, cards, marketing allowed, business name, birth date, and note. This means that apps offered in Europe need to make additional considerations over which permissions they need and whether they can minimize their requested data across a whole new swath of permissions. Apps with a customer focus may need to be particularly choosy about the exact information they'll touch on. Another special case is the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, which enforces restrictions on sharing personal healthcare data. In Clover terms, this means that certain types of merchants, based on their merchant category code, or MCC, cannot access apps that request inventory or customer permissions. Therefore, if your app is targeting a healthcare vertical, keep in mind that you will be unable to utilize these permissions. even if your target audience doesn't fall into a special case category, it will still affect the sorts of data you might need or need to avoid. Take Clover's merchant plans. Every merchant will be on a certain plan, and that plan will inform the functionality that merchant can access. These discrete chunks of functionality accessible by certain software as a service plans are called modules. So, like you can see here, an app whose core features rely on orders and items is usable by Register Lite merchants and above. Merchants on the Payments Plus plan do not have access to orders or items, and so cannot use this app. When you consider what merchant plans you're targeting, you're therefore also considering what permissions you can request. So, target audience is an important consideration when thinking about the data your app requires, or whether you should try to reduce the data your app requests. In this module example, not only would requesting items cut out Payments Plus users, it would also cut out healthcare merchants from your potential user base. If you reduce the permissions you request, or minimize your data, you could reach a larger set of merchants. By now, we've extensively gone over why you might want or need to reduce your data. Actually putting that into practice can be trickier. For help with tightening up app concepts or limiting an app scope, feel free to engage with community or reach out to us early on. Trimming unnecessary permissions early streamlines your development and our review process. In the meantime, let's take a look at a specific use case. Consider an all-in-one loyalty app with added reporting that's requesting every permission. How can we minimize our data requests? What could we trim? Now, in some cases, we might be able to split this concept completely with one app for loyalty and a separate one for reporting. But let's say that we want to integrate some reporting with the loyalty program to keep track of the merchant's best-selling items and categories. These graphs will allow the merchant to make informed decisions on their next loyalty rewards offers. Even if we're not splitting the app apart completely, there are still plenty of ways to cut down the permissions we're using. We can cross off most of our write permissions automatically. The reporting side of our app doesn't need them, and the loyalty side of our app only ever changes orders to add rewarded discounts. Employee data doesn't fit the schema. There are certainly apps that include employee data in reporting, such as for calculating commissions, but this app is all about the customer. Loyalty rewards tend to be centered around what the customer buys, such as buy 10 drinks, get one free, or how much they buy, such as spend $50 on one order and get a $5 gift card. All of this information is available through orders, so we can also axe payments permissions. Another useful tip, not pictured here, is that read permissions can be unnecessary when the app creates the object you want to read. If you create the order, you already have the order information. We've cut a lot of permissions, and all that's left now is to justify the remaining ones. After you finalize the permissions you'll require, let us know how you use each one and call out specific API endpoints or SDK classes you use with them. This will help us understand how the permission fits into the larger whole of your app when we review it. For example, for orders read, we might say that we need it to check whether orders contain line items that qualify for rewards, and that we use order connectors get order method along with orders get line items. As our app approvals overview webinar discusses, we use these justifications to inform both the functional and legal review of an app, so providing detailed information here and pointing out where you use permissions in your functional video will help set you up for success during the approval process. And there you have it, a glimpse into our permission system, the data behind it, and what you can do to reduce the data you touch, whether because you want to target specific merchant verticals or open your app to a broader merchant base. As some ending takeaways, note that even if an app is already published, it can be useful to review the app's requested permissions and consider whether any could be removed. This will keep the app usable by as wide a swath of merchants as possible as the digital landscape changes. Removing permissions does not trigger review gates, so you can remove permissions at your discretion. On the flip side, if you believe your app will require more permissions in the future than you currently request, be upfront and let us know early. While we won't be able to approve permissions early, we'll store your justifications and reasoning. Whenever you request additional permissions, be as specific and granular with your new justifications as you would when submitting an app, as this extra data will require a secondary review. If you go this route, note that merchants agree to permissions at the time of install. Any existing merchants will need to uninstall and reinstall the app to receive new permissions. It is therefore advisable for your app to gracefully handle cases where merchants are still on the old permission set. And finally, build for your target audience and be aware of how that changes available permissions. If your target audience is everyone, say you want to make a general calculator or note-taking app, reduce your permissions. You can only reach everyone with as few permissions as possible. And to minimize our talk down to the too long didn't read version, sometimes you can do more with less. Thanks for listening, and you can find the slides for this talk, complete with appendix with further resources, linked below.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Emily, for teaching all of us about data minimization. I definitely learned a lot. I love your end quote. You can only reach a larger audience with as few permissions as possible. All right. So thank you, everybody, for attending this webinar. We hope that it was very helpful for you. And if you want to help us shape the developer webinars, or you want to help us choose which topic you want us to go over, please fill out the survey that we'll be sending shortly. Thank you, everyone, for coming, and we will see all of you at the next webinar. Goodbye.